Committee on Science, Space, and Technology will come to order. With that objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the committee at any time. Welcome to today's hearing entitled EPA Regulatory Overreach Impacts on Industry. I'm going to recognize myself for 5 minutes for an opening statement, and then we'll do the same for the ranking member. Over the last year, the Environmental Protection Agency has released some of the most expensive and expansive regulations in its history. These rules will cost billions of dollars, place a heavy burden on American families, and diminish the competitiveness of American industry around the world. Today's hearing will examine this administration's unprecedented regulatory agenda and the manner in which EPA has used secret science, questionable legal interpretations, and flawed analysis to promote these rules. Specifically, we will hear from our witnesses about how the Clean Power Plan, the Ozone National Ambient Air Quality Standards, and the definition of the waters of the United States adversely impact the American economy with little benefit to our environment. The so-called Clean Power Plan is a power grab that will force states to reach arbitrary and often impossible targets for carbon emissions. These measures will impose tremendous cost on everyday Americans. It will shut down large numbers of affordable power plants, which increases the cost of electricity and puts the reliability of the electric grid into question. The Clean Power Plan will have an even greater impact on those who live on fixed incomes, such as the elderly and the poor, who are the most vulnerable to increases in the price of some of our most basic necessities like electricity. EPA asserts that the Clean Power Plan will help combat climate change. However, EPA's own data demonstrates that this is not the case. The EPA data shows that this regulation would eliminate much less than 1% of global carbon emissions and would reduce sea level rise by only 1/100th of an inch, the thickness of 3 sheets of paper. This rule represents massive cost without significant benefits. In other words, it's all pain and no gain. EPA also seeks to impose stricter ozone standards by lowering the standard from the current 75 parts per billion to between 65 to 70 ppb. Analysis conducted by EPA shows that this rule would cost at least $15 billion annually, and industry groups believe the cost will be even greater. Once again, these costs come with few benefits. In fact, EPA's own figures show that since 1980, ozone levels have decreased by 33%. Today's air quality will continue to improve with the expected development of practical new technologies. Last week, the EPA submitted its final rule to define waters of the United States. This is the EPA's latest attempt to expand its jurisdiction and increase its power to regulate American waterways, even if that means invading Americans' backyards. The rule will make it difficult for farmers and others to improve their land and expand their businesses. While the draft rule left many questions as to which bodies of water the EPA will claim under its jurisdiction, the final rule is more specific. As many had predicted, EPA has claimed unprecedented jurisdiction over many kinds of water, including those that temporarily result from a, quote, drizzle. The EPA actually uses that word, drizzle. EPA will now have the authority to oversee features such as prairie potholes, and even areas that are not always filled with water. Under this regulatory regime, Americans will be subject to required permits and the constant threat of government intervention. The onslaught of EPA regulations continues. I look forward to hearing from today's witnesses about the impact of these burdensome EPA regulations, and now recognize the ranking member, the gentlewoman from Texas, Ms. Johnson, for her opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Unfortunately, today's hearing is just a continuation of the same familiar theme we've heard in this Congress, resistance to the EPA's efforts to carry out its mission to protect the nation's environment and the public health, resistance that is unsupported by scientific evidence. It thus should not be a surprise that this hearing, like all others on EPA's activities, will fail to offer any constructive solutions for lowering ozone and cutting carbon emissions. Instead, it will serve as one of the more platforms for industry to voice its opposition to regulations that will make the air we breathe cleaner, the water we drink safer, and that will help address the looming challenge of climate change. Just this week, as a matter of fact, about 30 leaders of denominations throughout the African American community, their national leadership, came to the Congressional Black Caucus to announce their national movement to support cleaning up the environment. And while congressional oversight of EPA's activities is appropriate, the hearings held by this committee have not met standards of serious oversight. For example, this committee has failed to bring the expertise necessary to truly examine the research, policies, and technologies needed to confront the most important environmental issues of our time, climate change. Instead, the so-called experts the majority has brought before this committee too often represent views from outside the mainstream of scientific community and are industry opponents with a vested interest in maintaining the status quo. It is puzzling to me that our committee is going down such a path, just as other nations and many in the business community are stepping up to address the challenge presented by climate change. Those nations and those businesses are looking to the United States government to provide leadership. Just last week, six major oil companies, including BP, Shell, and Total, sent a letter to the United Nations recognizing climate change and the role of their companies in lowering carbon emissions. In the letter, they state, "For us to do more, we need governments across the world to provide us with clear, stable, long-term, ambitious policy frameworks. This would reduce uncertainty and help stimulate investments in the right low-carbon technologies and the right resources at the right pace." It is unfortunate that instead of contributing to the development of this long-term policy that these oil companies are asking Congress for, this committee has too often become a forum for climate change denial. With respect to today's hearing, it is clear that a cleaner environment and a stronger economy are not mutually exclusive. Stricter pollution limits have historically led to innovation and the creation of new technologies that have wound up creating jobs while protecting our environment. I am confident American industry will continue that record of innovation and job creation as new environmental standards are adopted. And finally, I'm proud to say that I was a nurse before I entered politics, and I can think of no mission of the federal government that is more important or noble than EPA's mission to protect human health and the environment. I look forward to Dr. Paulson's testimony on the public health benefits of environmental regulations we will be discussing today. In closing, I look forward to the day when this Congress and this committee will step back from the counterproductive opposition to EPA's efforts to carry out its statutorily mandated mission. It is not a good use of our time, and I hope that we can instead come together to advance our economy and a cleaner environment and healthier public. Mr. Chairman, before I yield back, I'd like to enter into the record the letter that I mentioned in my remarks. I thank you and yield back the balance of my time.
Without objection, and while we're asking unanimous consent to put items into the record, I'd like to ask unanimous consent to put into the record letters or documents we received from the Small Business and Entrepreneurship Council, from the American Chemistry Council, and that does it for right now. Thank you, Ms. Johnson, for your opening statement. Let me go on and introduce our witnesses today. And our first witness is Mr. Bob Kerr, President of Kerr Environmental Services Corporation. Mr. Kerr has 29 years' experience as an environmental consultant, specializing in stream and wetland mitigation, natural resources consulting, National Environmental Policy Act compliance, and environmental contaminant studies. Mr. Kerr received his bachelor's degree in biology from the State University of New York at Fredonia and his master's degree in marine environmental sciences from Stony Brook University. Our next witness today is Mr. Bill Kovacs, Senior Vice President for Environment, Technology, and Regulatory Affairs at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Kovacs initiates and leads multidimensional national issue campaigns on comprehensive energy legislation, complex environmental rulemakings, telecommunications reform, emerging technologies, and the systematic application of sound science to the federal regulatory process. Mr. Kovacs received his bachelor's degree from the University of Scranton and his law degree from Ohio State University. Our next witness is Dr. Jerome Paulson, Chair of the American Association of Pediatrics Council on Environmental Health Executive Committee. Dr. Paulson also directs the Mid-Atlantic Center for Children's Health and Environment, a federally funded environmental health specialty unit that provides education and outreach to health professionals, parents, and the community. In addition, Dr. Paulson has served as a special assistant to the Director of Centers for Disease Control's National Center on Environmental Health. Dr. Paulson received his bachelor's degree in biochemistry from the University of Maryland and his MD from Duke University. Our final witness today, Mr. Ross Eisenberg, Vice President of Energy and Resources Policy at the National Association of Manufacturers. Mr. Eisenberg oversees NAM's energy and environmental policy work and has expertise on issues that range from energy production and use to air and water quality, energy efficiency, and environmental regulation. Before joining NAM in 2012, Mr. Eisenberg spent more than 5 years as Environmental and Energy Counsel at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Eisenberg received his bachelor's degree in English and political science from Emory University and his law degree from Washington Lee University School of Law. And we welcome you all, look forward to your testimony today, and Mr. Kerr, we'll begin with you.
Thank you.
Make sure your mic is on there.
Thank you. Chairman Smith, members of the committee, I appreciate the opportunity to testify today. My name is Bob Kerr, and I'm president of Kerr Environmental Services, an environmental consulting and water resources engineering firm located in Virginia Beach, Virginia. I've provided wetlands consulting and permitting assistance throughout Virginia and North Carolina for more than 26 years. Since 1972, the Clean Water Act has played an important role in improving the quality of the nation's water resources. Yet there continues to be frustration and uncertainty over the scope of the act and the appropriate role of the federal government in protecting the nation's waters. Decades after the enactment of the Clean Water Act, there's still no easy way to determine if certain types of waters are subject to state law or federal mandates. EPA and the Corps recently issued a rule intended to clarify what is subject to federal regulation. Unfortunately, the rule does not provide the needed predictability and certainty in the permitting process. It fails to follow the intent of Congress, ignores Supreme Court precedent, and does not respect the authority of the state to regulate their land and water resources. The agencies claim the rule does not expand federal jurisdiction, but that's simply not the case. The rule establishes a broader definition of tributaries, which for the first time includes ditches and streams that only flow after it rains. It also allows the agencies to regulate intermittent and ephemeral drainages by rule, classifying them as tributaries, whereas before the agencies required an analysis of their significant nexus to traditional navigable waters before federal jurisdiction could be established. While this certainly provides clarity, it does not limit jurisdiction. The new definition of neighboring includes areas that were not previously federally regulated, such as non-wetlands located more than a quarter of a mile from a traditional navigable water, or similar features located within a floodplain and up to 1,500 feet from the feature. Moreover, the agencies retain extensive authority to interpret certain ambiguous definitions as they see fit. This will allow for the inconsistent application of the rule among regulators, both within a core district and across the country. Ultimately, the rule will lead to more litigation, project delays, more landowners needing permits, and a higher cost of permitting, avoidance, and mitigation. You might look at the rule and think it's a dream come true for a consultant like me because more regulation will mean more business. I fear the exact opposite. Under the new rule, I'll need to complete more jurisdictional determinations and will have to conduct multiple tests to determine whether a feature qualifies as a water of the U.S. It'll take additional time and resources to complete the tests, and that will cost clients more money. Not knowing their permit costs in advance increases financial risk for my clients. As such, clients may decide not to pursue some projects as a result. Some cases may also be so complex that they are too time-consuming or costly to resolve. In such cases, clients have the option to concede federal jurisdiction and proceed with permitting and mitigation through a preliminary jurisdictional determination. But that isn't a fair program to me, nor does it keep with the legislative intent of the Clean Water Act. And that's not good for the economy as a whole. To start to fix this, we need a new rule that respects the state's role in regulating waters. Many aspects of the Clean Water Act are vague, but it's clear that Congress intended to create a partnership between the federal agencies and state government to protect our nation's water resources. The Supreme Court has twice affirmed that the Clean Water Act places limits on federal authority. There is a point where federal authority ends and state authority begins. The final rule published by the EPA and Corps would assert jurisdiction over many features that are isolated, carry only minor volumes of water, or have only theoretical impacts on traditional navigable waters. These waters are properly regulated by the states. The federal government cannot just assert jurisdiction over everything, yet that appears to be the agency's solution. And many of the bright line limits written into the rule seem so large in scale or so vague as to have created no actual limitations. Precedent suggests that the courts will again have to rein in the overarching rule, but only after countless years of litigation. The wiser path forward is for Congress to act now. Let's get the agencies to withdraw the rule, resolve the problems, provide the clarity we need as to what constitutes a water of the United States. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Mr. Novick.
Thank you, Chairman Smith and Ranking Member Johnson and members of the committee. For my opening remarks today, I'm going to address the question many of us have been asking for a while. How did an Environmental Protection Agency acquire such great power over energy policy, state waters, land use, and the nation's economic development at the expense of states, which implement over 90% of the federally delegated programs and are the main point of contact for the regulated community? The purpose of regulation is to implement the laws passed by Congress in the most efficient way to achieve the congressional intent. In the 1970s, Congress, when it enacted these environmental laws, had very little knowledge of how to protect the environment. It also recognized that while it was protecting the environment, it would cause, and I emphasize, they recognized in 1970, it would cause plants to shut down, jobs to be lost, and harm to the impacted communities. But to deal with this dilemma, Congress gave the EPA very broad authorities to protect the environment, but also mandated that the EPA continuously evaluate the potential loss or shifts in employment resulting from the regulations, so that Congress could make corrections based on actual input. Congress also authorized citizen suits by granting access to the courts to anyone protecting the environment, in effect granting special environmental enforcement authorities to private sector entities. Then in 1984, the Supreme Court granted deference to EPA's decisions where Congress was silent or vague on any of the statutory provisions in thousands of pages of legislation. In essence, the Supreme Court authorized EPA to fill in all of the gaps in the legislation. Almost from the beginning, EPA missed a high percentage of its congressionally mandated deadlines. Since EPA misses between 84% and 98% of its deadlines, depending on which study you believe, citizen suits were brought to force EPA to comply with the deadlines. Rather than arguing it had discretion in meeting the conflicting priorities, EPA entered into consent decrees with advocacy groups agreeing to implement the regulations requested, thereby letting these groups set the policy for the agency and the priorities. The best illustration of the impact of sue and settle process is that between 2000 and 2013 timeframe, approximately 425 agencies issued almost 50,000 regulations, but only 30 of those regulations were costing over $1 billion a year to the regulated community or to the states. And EPA issued 17 of the 30. And those 17 account for 82% of all the costs for all 30 rules. Beginning in 1980 and onward, Congress passed numerous regulatory laws to provide guidance to the agencies on the type of information needed by the agency to ensure that it complied with Congress's intent to have a sound rulemaking record that was built on facts, science, and economics. These statutes were the Information Quality Act, the Regulatory Flexibility Act, and unfunded mandates reform. EPA routinely ignores congressional mandates, and more importantly, it has never started in 35 years a continuing evaluation of the employment impacts of its regulations, thereby leaving Congress without the information needed to legislate. Therefore, what the condition we have today, the circumstances we find ourselves in, is we have an agency that you have given broad delegated authority to make policy. You have a federal judiciary that has said that anything that you don't describe in clear terms, that they have, based on deference, they have the authority to fill in the legislative gaps. The development of secret sue and settle agreements allows these advocacy groups to set agency policy, and we have an agency that for 35 years has refused to evaluate the impact of regulations on employment. We also have an agency that routinely ignores congressional mandates to try to fix the regulatory record through having the agency talk to small businesses, find out what the unfunded mandates are in state and local governments, and use sound science and factual information. If Congress wants its laws implicated according to what you believe you've legislated, it must ensure that the agencies are accountable to Congress, that the rulemaking process is transparent, that it operates with integrity, and provides all of the participants the same rights as they participate in the federal rulemaking process. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kovac. Dr. Polson.
Good morning, Chairman Smith, Ranking Member Johnson, and committee members. Chairman Smith, thank you for your kind introduction of me, and I will just add that for 30 to 35 years, I also practiced and taught.
Mr. Chairman, is the mic on?
I practiced and taught primary care pediatrics, so I was directly involved in the day-to-day pediatric care of children. And so with the background that you described and my work as a pediatrician that I mentioned, I'm going to comment today on the child health benefits of the Clean Power Plan and the EPA's proposed ozone rule. We know very clearly that children are disproportionately at risk from environmental pollutants. Children are not little adults, and we cannot extrapolate from what we know about adults and assume that that information applies to children. Particularly as it relates to respiratory illnesses, children breathe faster than adults, they have higher levels of physical activity, and they spend more time outdoors. Their lungs are still developing. Therefore, children have different outcomes from exposures to ozone and other air pollutants than adults do, and these effects on children last a lifetime. Problems that develop in children manifest themselves in adulthood. The work of EPA is essential to protecting children from pollutants and ensuring that children have an optimal environment in which to live, learn, and play. Reducing carbon emissions of fossil fuel-powered plants represents a major step towards addressing a key component of climate change in the U.S. According to the World Health Organization, over 80% of the current health burden from the changing climate is on children less than 5 years old, and that's children here in the U.S. as well as globally. These burdens on children include injury and death from natural disasters, increases in air pollution-related illness, and more heat-related potentially fatal illness. Reducing carbon pollution will have an immediate impact on child health by reducing emissions of other pollutants and the resultant creation of harmful ozone. When fully implemented in 2030, EPA's proposed rule for existing power plants will result in 6,600 fewer premature deaths, 150,000 fewer childhood asthma attacks, and 180,000 fewer missed school days, 3,700 fewer cases of bronchitis. This also means that when children are not sick, their parents can go to work, keep their jobs, and earn money for the family. Let me tell you about a phone call that I received from a physician about a little girl with asthma. The family and the physician were having difficulty keeping her asthma under control in spite of adequate medical management. The astute mother reported that her daughter's asthma got worse when the smoke from the power plant that was located near her home changed from white to black. We were able to determine that the power plant usually burns natural gas, but was approved to burn coal under certain circumstances. We believe that this little girl's asthma was exacerbated by the coal burning because of the increase in particulate and other air pollutants associated with that fuel. It is also clear and compelling scientific evidence that supports the need for a strong ozone standard of 60 parts per billion or lower. High levels of ozone in the air, including levels above 60 parts per billion, can lead to decreased lung function in children, coughing, burning, and shortness of breath, as well as inflammation and swelling of the airways. In 2025, a 60 part per billion standard could prevent 7,900 premature deaths, 1.8 million child asthma attacks, and 1.9 million missed school days. I know that the distinguished members of this committee have given many speeches over the course of your career, and I'm sure that all of you would be horrified, as I was, to look out at a crowd that you were addressing to see a woman in the audience sobbing. But that was my experience during a luncheon presentation talking about ozone as a cause of asthma and a reason for exacerbation of asthma. This mom was blaming herself for being a good mother and encouraging her son to be physically active and involved in outdoor sports, only to have him develop asthma. The EPA has a fundamental role in assuring that the environment in which children live, learn, and play is safe and healthy, and allows children to enter adulthood free from environmentally related health problems. The Clean Power Plan and stronger ozone NACs are essential child health policies that the AAP strongly supports. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Paulson and Mr. Eisenberg.
Good morning, Chairman Smith, Ranking Member Johnson, members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today to present the views of the National Association of Manufacturers and our 14,000 members. Manufacturers believe regulation is critical to the protection of worker safety, public health, and our environment. We believe in the mission of the EPA, and we support reasonable environmental regulation. However, we also bear an unmistakably high burden of compliance with the agency's regulations. Manufacturers spend, on average, over $19,000 per employee per year on regulatory compliance, and over $10,000 of this is for environmental regulations. The smaller the manufacturer, though, the larger the burden. Manufacturers with less than 50 employees spend over $34,000 per employee per year, and over $20,000 of this is due to environmental regulations. So when the EPA issues a new regulation with new costs and new burdens, manufacturers have to pay these costs on top of what we're already doing, the tens of thousands of dollars that we've already assumed. So we're not starting from zero. In fact, our plants are already equipped with the best available pollution control technology. We maximize our efficiency, and we limit waste and we recycle. And so while we'll always strive for improvement, in some cases we're really already pushing up against or beyond what technology can deliver. And so what we need as manufacturers more than ever are smarter regulations. We just don't believe we're getting that from the EPA with respect to the three regulations that we're here to talk about today, ozone, the Clean Power Plan, and the Waters of the United States definition. In all three cases, the cost and burdens placed on manufacturers as a result of these regulations are very significant and could make us significantly less competitive. Manufacturers are committed to reducing ozone levels, and we've been doing so for decades. We've been reducing the emissions that cause ozone by more than half since 1980. However, the progress we've made, it also means that both the low-hanging fruit and the high-hanging fruit are pretty much gone. And so the controls that are needed to reduce ozone levels are already in place. In fact, with this rule, EPA can only identify about 35% of the controls and technologies needed to achieve this new 65 parts per billion standard. You heard that right. A solid two-thirds of the controls that will be needed to comply to this are called unknown controls. We don't know what they are. Economic analysis of this new standard shows that it would be the most expensive regulation in history. Second place isn't even close. It would cost about $140 billion per year, about $1.7 trillion over the next 23 years, placing the equivalent of 1.4 million jobs in jeopardy each year and reducing annual household consumption by an average of about $830 per year. Very few low-cost control options exist for this tightening ozone standard. So if controls aren't invented in time, what winds up happening is manufacturers are forced to consider scrapping equipment, scrapping existing plants, replacing them, or just plain old shutting them down. And then there's non-attainment for ozone, which is essentially a synonym for no growth. There has to be a better way for this than this, and really there is. The current standard is only now being implemented. It's going to drive ozone precursor emissions, the emissions that cause ozone, down by another 36% over the next decade. We believe we should let that standard work before moving the chains one more time. On climate, we're committed to addressing climate change through improved energy efficiency, greater sustainability, and reducing our greenhouse gas emissions. We've done that. We reduced our emissions 10% over the past decade. But our competitiveness is threatened by the Clean Power Plan as it's currently drafted. Independent analysis of this rule places total compliant costs as high as about $366 billion through 2031. 43 states could experience double-digit electricity prices. That's very difficult for us as we are major, major energy users. And even worse, many sectors in my membership, manufacturing, are due to get follow-on regulations under the Act that will be modeled off of this one, meaning we're going to be hit twice. We believe EPA needs to fix this rule. We agree that adoption of a strong and fair international climate agreement should be a priority. But we also must be very careful not to lock into place policies that will send production and emissions overseas if the rest of the world doesn't play by those same rules in Paris in December. Finally, manufacturers are disappointed with the final waters of the U.S. regulation. We would welcome a clear rule that resolves disagreement over scope of the Clean Water Act. Instead, we ended up with a final regulation that fails to do this. It fails to clear up the problems and may have even created new ones. The regulation certainly expands the scope of the Clean Water Act to areas that are not even wet, and it fails to provide clear exclusions as to what actually qualifies. Manufacturers are going to face increased uncertainty, permitting costs, and supply and consumer chain disruptions. Ambiguities in the new regulation will give rise to third-party lawsuits, even in cases where EPA agrees with us and believes that it is not a water of the United States. I assure you we do not enjoy having to have an adversarial position to the EPA on these regulations. We prefer to work with them as a partner toward a shared goal protecting the environment. However, we desperately need the EPA to choose a different regulatory path. Sadly, we are nearing the time where legislation may be our only hope, and we ask this committee for its help in that pursuit. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Eisenberg, and I'll recognize myself for questions. And Mr. Kerr, let me direct my first question to you. The EPA claims that under the waters of the U.S. final rule, it does not expand the scope of federal jurisdiction. Give me a couple of quick examples as to why it does expand jurisdiction.
Sure. Under the Swank Supreme Court ruling, the Supreme Court found that isolated wetlands are not under the jurisdiction of the Clean Water Act, and if they're to be regulated at all, they need to be regulated by the state. Those types of isolated wetlands can now be regulated under the Clean Water Act. Under the new rule, they can be regulated as an adjacent water. So that's one type of situation where scope's broadened.
Okay. By the way, I'm just curious, have we seen the word drizzle before, water that's accumulated as a result of drizzle?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay, that might be another example.
Yeah, and actually, I've got three or four others. There has never been an adjacent feature regulated under the Clean Water Act other than wetlands. The only adjacent feature could be a wetland. Under the new rule, a pond can be considered adjacent. Virtually any kind of other water of the U.S. can be considered adjacent. That's a new precedent and was not dictated by a court decision. Ditches flowing into tributaries can now be regulated as a jurisdictional water. I've got a lot of concern with that because, by definition, ditches connect into waters of the United States so that they drain agriculture, roads, stormwater, you know, a number of features. If they connect to a traditionally navigable water or a tributary, the EPA is saying they can regulate them now. And that creates, at a minimum, a lot of confusion.
And that's another expansion. Mr. Kerr, I know you could go on and on and on. Let me see if I can get to some other questions. Mr. Kovacs, real quickly, you say that the modeling system used by the EPA is biased. What's an example, and specifically of a way that it's biased?
Well, I mean, there are several things. One is when we did our own modeling on costs several years ago, we found that EPA used what they call a limited model where the only thing they looked at was what are the impacts on job growth, and that was very narrow in the sense that it asked how many consultants are you going to have. So when it did model the MAC rule, for example, it found that there were, it created 8,000 jobs. When we used whole economy modeling, we found that it lost 240,000 jobs. And that's one of the huge debates that's going on right now with the Science Advisory Board. They've been instructed by Congress to determine whether or not EPA's modeling is incorrect.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Kovacs. Dr. Paulson, first of all, you mentioned your testimony. I just want to bring it out for everybody's information that since 1990, emissions of six common pollutants have dropped by 41% through 2008. I think that's good news. You also mentioned the heartfelt case of a girl with asthma, and whenever the smoke from the power plant located near her home changed from white to black, when they went from burning natural gas to coal, her asthma worsened. We've done some research, and our research indicates that typically a coal-fired plant produces white smoke, not black smoke, and I'll show you a couple of photographs. Do you know where this plant was located that you referred to?
Yes, sir, I do.
What city or what area? I don't want to. You don't need to get anybody's identity. I'm just curious where it's located.
Washington, D.C.
Okay. And, well, we'll have to check because my information is that even when they're burning coal, the smoke is white, not black, and that might be of interest. Anyway, just wanted to bring that out. Appreciate that. My last question goes to Mr. Eisenberg. And this is, does the EPA have the legal authority to implement the proposed clean power plan?
Certainly that is an open question. I mean, I fear that if they finalize the rule that they proposed, we're going to get some litigation on that. We and others have posed a number of potential legal obstacles that this thing could go through. They certainly have the authority to regulate mm-hmm. greenhouse gases. That's been settled by the Supreme Court. The issue is, can they be using this statute the way they're using it? They've certainly made a lot of interesting choices in terms of going well outside.
Do you have a legal opinion yourself as to?
You know, it's going to be a complicated case. I think, you know, certainly there are a lot of potential flaws, legal flaws in this.
Okay, what's an example of one?
So a very easy one is whether or not the Section 111 can be used in light of the fact that mm-hmm. they are already regulating power plants under Section 112 for hazardous air pollution. Can you actually do that under Section 111? And if so, can you do that for everybody else? They didn't make an independent endangerment finding for this one, so they just basically said, well, cars cause this, and so power plants must too. Okay. There's a lot of stuff baked in there that I think is going to be a real challenge.
Thank you, Mr. Eisenberg. And the gentlewoman from Texas, the ranking member, Ms. Johnson, is recognized for her questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Paulson, in your in the testimony of Mr. Kovas, he recommended EPA retain the current 2008 ozone standard of 75 parts per billion, in large part because EPA is just now starting to implement the 2008 standard. Those who support retaining the current standard say it is unfair for EPA to move the goalpost by calling for more stringent standard. As most people know, I'm from Dallas, Texas, an area that is all too familiar with poor air quality. Dallas County alone is home to more than 60,000 children and over 130,000 adults with asthma who are at risk of missing school, missing work, ending up in an emergency room or hospital, and even dying prematurely on days with dangerous ozone levels at government expense. Unfortunately, the state of Texas is not helping to protect my constituents nor anybody else's, and has been intensely opposed to a lower ozone standard. In fact, the chairman of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, Brian Shaw, has stated that there will be little to no public health benefit from lowering the current standard. Was the current standard of 75 parts per billion sufficient to protect public health when it was finalized in 2008 is one question. And the second question, how has the body of scientific evidence changed since the last time EPA revised ozone standard, and would it make sense based on the science for EPA to retain the current standard until the states have fully implemented as some have suggested.
Ms. Johnson, if the states retain the current standard until it's fully implemented, people are going to die and people are going to be sick. We knew before the current standard was set by EPA, based on the science that was available prior to that time, that that standard was inadequate to protect the health of human beings in the United States. We now have additional scientific information, both from human epidemiologic studies and other research, that shows that a level of 60 is where health protection starts.
Thank you very much. Are you likely aware that critics of the Clean Power Plan and virtually any other EPA rule often claim that the economy and the American consumer will suffer as a result of efforts to make our environment cleaner and safer? This sky is falling attitude toward protecting the health of Americans run counter to reality. As the economy has tripled in size since the adoption of the Clean Air Act in 1970, claims that regulations kills jobs are equally misleading. As a matter of fact, I've known it to create jobs. In fact, just last year, we heard from the witnesses that wise environmental protection and robust economic development can and should go hand in hand. That being said, one cost is abundantly clear, and that is the cost of American lives. If we do not enact regulations to protect their public health, now, can you please expand upon the cost to public health if we do not act and implement stronger emission regulations? And what are the costs to the taxpayers, especially medical costs, if businesses are allowed to continue to pollute?
Ms. Johnson, the issues around ozone in particular and all of the rest of the issues, air pollutants that come under the Clean Power Plan, each and every one of them adversely affects human health and therefore costs money. Costs money in terms of direct out-of-pocket costs for payment of medical expenses, or the government pays those expenses if it's not direct out-of-pocket, or business pays those expenses in terms of insurance premiums. Businesses also pay an expense for these health problems when their workers can't show up or show up sick and can't do the work that they need to do. Businesses also pay for these health problems when children are ill because their parents need to stay home with the children, need to take their children to a healthcare professional, need to take their children to an emergency room, or need to sit by their child's bedside in the hospital. One of my colleagues, Dr. Leonardo Trasande from NYU Medical School, and a colleague of his, Dr. Liu, concluded that the best estimate of childhood asthma costs in 2008, and recognized that they've only gone up since then, that could be associated just with environmental factors. This is not the total cost of asthma. This is a cost attributable to environmental factors, was around $2.2 billion per year in the United States, with a range from about $728 million to $2.5 billion. So by not protecting our people, there is an extensive economic burden on businesses and on the country as a whole.
Thank you very much. My time has expired.
Thank you, Ms. Johnson. And the gentleman from California, Mr. Rohrabacher, is recognized.
Years ago, when I was in high school, which seems really, I guess it was, on another century, I remember when we, and I was in Los Angeles going to high school, and we were not permitted to go out and do strenuous exercises because the pollution levels in Los Angeles were so high that perhaps once or twice a week they called on a pollution emergency. Today, I think that happens once or twice a year. So there has been a dramatic reduction in the air pollution, at least in Southern California, and I take it from the testimony that we've heard that that's true throughout the rest of the country as well. I was wondering, and we have to attribute that to the fact that there has been regulation that has been successful. And those of us who have a natural inclination against regulation need to be honest about that. And the question is whether or not we have come to a point, and or when we did come to that point, where such regulation actually does not clean the air, but there are natural sources of pollution when you have to want to maintain a certain standard of living for people. I mean, if we're going to have civilization, there will be manufacturing will take place. If you do not have manufacturing, people will get sick for other reasons other than just the air. The question is for you, Dr. Polson, has there been a decrease in the number of illnesses, air pollution-related illnesses that has been recorded in these last 10 to 15 years as the pollution levels gone down?
It depends what pollutant you're looking at and what particular health outcome you are looking at, but we do know that the pollution levels have come down, and we also know that the current pollution levels are not healthy.
You're not answering my question, please. I'm asking you specifically, those the pollution levels have gone down, and now do we see, as the pollution levels have gone down, this decrease in the number of diseases related to that pollution?
There's been some leveling off, for example, of people with asthma.
So we have only had a leveling off, and not there's been this dramatic decrease in the pollution, but there's only been a leveling off. So maybe we have reached a point that the pollution level is more of a natural level that human beings can relate to. Perhaps maybe the other witness.
These levels of pollution are dangerous to human beings, Mr. Rohrabacher. These levels of pollution are produced by human beings and can be controlled by human beings.
Well, there are also, as we know, natural. For example, we hear we are called deniers over here if we don't go along with the fact that CO2 is changing our climate. But we know that 90% of the CO2 in the air comes from natural sources and not human sources. And at some point, you have to relate what level of what we're ever talking about actually relates directly to people's health. And do other witnesses have
Mr. Rohrabacher,
could I ask the other witnesses to comment on that as well?
We did a study using EPA's own data just to figure out that exact question. And we asked it in each of the studies that EPA was doing in terms of reducing a pollutant, whether it be ozone or mercury or whatever. EPA, let's use mercury. EPA, the entire utility MAC was mercury, but only $6 million out of $10 billion in EPA's claim benefits came from mercury. The rest came from particulate matter. And what's happened is we've taken particulate matter down to where it's 30% below where EPA says it's safe and 20% below where the World Health Organization says it's safe. We're still reducing it. So we're spending billions of dollars to reduce something that's already 30% below what they say is safe.
So at some point, whereas if you have a problem and at some point you come to a position where it is no longer cost effective to do that, to have that activity, and while we have to admit that from the time when I was in high school till now when the pollution level's lower, that maybe that was very cost effective and many of the things that the good doctor is telling us about has resulted from that. But maybe we now have reached a point where it's so costly that it's counterproductive. And as you know, on our side of the aisle at least, we believe that entrepreneurs and manufacturers, when you actually put them in contest with the bureaucracy, they usually lose. And bureaucracy, where manufacturers can give us good products to use, usually bureaucracy is able to turn pure energy into solid waste, and that's about all.
Thank you, Mr. Warnock. The gentleman from Maryland, Ms. Edwards, is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the witnesses this morning. I just want to make sure that we really understand, because I think sometimes there are quite overstatements in these hearings, and so I just want to clarify from the EPA that the Clean Water Rule does not regulate most ditches. In fact, the text of the rule says, and I quote, the following are not waters of the United States. The following ditches, A, ditches with ephemeral flow that are not relocated tributary or excavated in a tributary. B, ditches with intermittent flow that are not relocated tributary, excavated in a tributary, or drain wetlands. And C, ditches that do not flow either directly or through another water into a traditional navigable water, interstate water, or territorial seas. And so let's not overstate the regulation of so-called ditches. I've heard that so many times, and it is completely inaccurate. Furthermore, the rule doesn't protect any types of waters that have not historically been covered by the Clean Water Act, any new requirements for agriculture. In fact, all of the agriculture that was exempt before is exempt now under the rule. Interfere with or change property rights, regulate most ditches, as I've said, change policy on irrigation or water transfers, address land use, cover erosional features such as gullies, rills, and non-wetland swales, and include groundwater, shallow subsurface flow, and tile drains. Those are things that the rule does not do, and so we should be careful about those overstatements. Mr. Chairman, I know also a number of my colleagues on the other side also deny that climate change is happening, or at least that humans are causing it. We've already heard that this morning, and have adamantly opposed the Obama administration's efforts to lower the nation's carbon emissions. Fortunately, according to a recent study by the Yale Project on Climate Change Communication, the majority of Republican voters actually support climate action to reduce carbon pollution. Additionally, a majority of moderate Republicans support setting limits on carbon emissions from coal-fired powered plants. This poll also shows that not all Republican voters oppose EPA's Clean Power Plan. And so, Mr. Chairman, I'd ask unanimous consent to enter these two charts from the Yale Project into the record.
Without objection, that will be made a part of the record.
Thank you. I also want to enter into the record a survey by Hart Research Associates that actually says that voters, in fact, support the Clean Water Rule. And not just that, but an overwhelming number of voters trust the EPA and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to do that and not Congress. I think that we should listen to the public.
Without objection, by the way, I'm looking at the poll that you're referring to. The wonder is that the answers weren't,
Mr. Chairman,
were not 100% given the way the questions were worded.
That's my time.
Who's opposed to clean water?
Are you entering that into the record? And I ask for the remainder of my time to be added back to the clock.
I'll give you 10 more seconds
for
my comments.
Mr. Chairman, I'd also like to add into the record, as we've seen this morning, again, that our industry representatives here make the argument that the cost of complying with regulations will, quote, kill the economy and jobs. But this argument has been proven false over and over again. Again, I have a fact sheet from the Pew Charitable Trust describing industry's long history of overestimating the cost of regulations. According to Pew, compliance costs have been less and benefits greater than industry predictions, and regulation typically poses little challenge to economic competitiveness. The fact sheet goes on to outline a number of very specific examples of this pattern of the over-exaggeration, from acid rain and airbags to seat belts and catalytic converters. For example, chemical production plants predicted that controlling benzene emissions would cost $350,000 per plant. But the chemical plants ended up actually developing a process that substituted other chemicals for benzene and virtually eliminated control costs. in this instance, as in a number of instances, regulation actually drove the kind of innovation, Mr. Chairman, that you pointed to. I'd ask unanimous consent to enter these fact sheets from the Pew Charitable Trust into the record.
Without objection.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to finish by saying we've had so many of these hearings about regulation, and I would suggest that we allow these rule to go into effect, and we don't have any predictions at all about what the outcome will be if they are challenged in court. But after, especially with the Clean Water Rule, after thousands and thousands of comments that have been reviewed, changes that were made from the rule on its introduction to the final proposed rule, hundreds of witnesses testifying, it's time that we move after a decade and a half of twiddling around and not knowing what to do and what the rules are, to a point where we have some certainty, that industry has certainty, that the public has certainty, and that all of us get the clean air and the clean water that we deserve. Thank you, and I yield.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards. The gentleman from California, Mr. Knight, is recognized for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would go on the line of questioning of kind of what we've done in California. I think that my statement would be that California has probably gone about this as stringent as any state in the union as far as our clean air, clean water, clean energy, clean everything that we have done. Not just, of course, on EPA standards, because everyone has to go up along with that, but what the legislature has done in California to go about this. So I guess my questions would be, and we can start with Mr. Kerr, that we have seen a loss in the last 10 years of about 80,000 manufacturing jobs in California, due in part to what we have done in California, not just by our regulations, but what we have mandated on business and how they can interact with the air and the water in California. Do you think that, and I think Mr. Rohrbacher was going down the right line of questioning, do you think we have hit a line in the road where if we go too far, then we're not going to just continue to hemorrhage jobs, but America and many parts of America will be so uncompetitive that business's only choice will be to look elsewhere?
Thank you, Congressman. With regard to the question, I have to say I'm not an air pollution consultant, so I'll just yield my time to the others here who could speak to that.
Congressman, I think you're going to be surprised my answer is I think we don't know, and the reason why I say that is part of when Congress first legislated these acts in the 1970s, you asked for very specific information. There was a debate on the floor that was really fascinating, and one of the members of one of the Democrats got up and said, you know, I'm tired of this issue being fought in this way. This is the end of the world, and this is and we're going to protect the world. And they specifically said, we know we're going to impact jobs. We know that. But Congress has a major role, and we need information to come back to us from the agency. You never got that. And then in the 80s and the 90s, Congress again said, we're going to pass the Information Quality Act. And what that said is the agency has to take information from the public, and the public has a right to challenge the agency's information. The agencies, not just EPA, have refused to do that. You've asked for input under the unfunded mandates from the impact on states. States implement 92% of all the environmental laws, and the EPA does not look at unfunded mandates. It generally dismisses and says there's no impact on the states. Even for ozone, EPA says there's no impact in the states. There's no unfunded mandate for a rule that they say is going to cost approximately $90 billion a year. So you don't know. And one of the things that's really needed in this issue is we fought over the issue for too long. You need the information on data quality to work. You need the information on 321A and the Clean Air Act to tell you how it's impacted jobs. Because regulations aren't just something that happens to the whole country. Regulations are something that happens to an industry. So if an industry is hit and it's in Wisconsin or Idaho or wherever, that industry and that community is affected. There may be jobs created elsewhere, but you still have an industry and a community that's been hurt. And you don't have that information, and EPA has never given it to you.
Thank you very much.
So I'm trying to give you a very simple answered specifically for manufacturing. You're absolutely right in terms of manufacturers. We use about a third of the energy in this country. We are extremely energy intensive. For some manufacturers, it is our single largest cost. There is a reason why a lot of the new manufacturing that is coming online is going to states where energy is cheap. If you are a state that does not have cheap energy, that is a very big difference maker for a lot of folks in industries that are highly energy intensive. That is not the driver. It is a driver of why manufacturers are going to places that, that may not be California, which absolutely has extraordinarily high energy costs.
Mr. Knight, we know very well that air pollution is not confined by political borders. We know this very well in the United States, but it is true internationally as well. And we can only do what we can do in the United States to protect our own citizens. And Congress gave the Environmental Protection Agency a responsibility to protect the health of human beings in our country. And that is what they are attempting to do by lowering these pollutant limits.
Absolutely, Dr. Paulson. I agree. I just think that we possibly, and I wouldn't say possibly, I would say we have achieved a level that is very healthy in this country. And going further, we will be hurting this country and its ability to economically be a factor. And I will say what we've done in California has worked very well. We have 6 of the dirtiest 10 cities in this country. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Knight. The gentlewoman from Oregon, Ms. Bonamici, is recognized for questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I'm going to follow up on the discussion we were just having. And Mr. Chairman, you mentioned this in your opening statement, too, about diminishing the competitiveness of U.S. businesses. And we hear these claims that the Clean Power Plan or other environmental laws are going to kill jobs, hurt the economy. There's a suggestion that our businesses will go overseas. I just read this morning that IKEA just pledged €1 billion, which is $1.13 billion, to help slow climate change through renewable energy and steps to help poor nations cope with climate change. They said this is good for customers, good for the climate, and good for their company. So they found that customers actually value environmental responsibility, and I suggest that we look at that and what our customers value. And I also want to talk about how the numbers speak for themselves. The Union of Concerned Scientists just released an analysis that shows that most states are already making significant progress toward cutting carbon emissions from power plants. And according to that analysis, 31 states, including my state of Oregon, are already more than halfway toward meeting the 2020 benchmarks set out by the EPA under the Clean Power Plan. All but 4 states have already made decisions that will help cut their power plant emissions. 14 states, including California, Kentucky, Ohio, and New York, are already ahead of the emission rate reduction trajectory because of current carbon-cutting decisions and actions. I find this very encouraging and, again, highlights how the environmental regulations can bring about positive results. Now, Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent to enter this analysis into the record.
Without objection.
Thank you. And, Mr. Eisenberg, I was glad to hear you say that the National Association of Manufacturers believes in the mission of the EPA. You say that plants have the best available pollution control technologies. And as we were just discussing, history shows that regulation drives innovation. Without the regulation, those who are working on new technologies don't have a market, but with the regulation, they do. And we have found that new technologies are developed to meet the needs of regulation. So I want to ask Dr. Paulson, you know, many are arguing that it's just not worth it, the costs are too high. And as you've noted, there's evidence showing that on balance, jobs are created, the economy expands following the passage of major environmental reforms. For example, in a report to Congress on the costs and benefits of federal regulations, OMB estimated that major rules promulgated by the EPA in the decade between 2003 and 2013 had benefits between $165 billion to $850 billion, compared to costs of $38 to $46 billion. That's a pretty significant return on investment. So, Dr. Paulson, alternatively, we've talked about the cost of ignoring our changing climate and the public health risks related to increases in global temperatures, and I note that the death toll in India is now up to 2,500 people. tragic over there. Climate change also has the potential to exacerbate existing health conditions, as you discussed, such as asthma. Now, we've had hearings in this committee before where we've talked about how the EPA is not allowed to consider the costs when they, for example, set the standard under the Clean Air Act. The ozone standard. That's sort of compared to the idea that you're going to make a medical diagnosis depending on how much the treatment's going to cost. So can you comment on the importance of separating the costs associated with attaining an ozone standard from the assessment of what level is appropriate to protect public health?
Health needs to be a priority. And as a physician, I am sworn, and I took an oath long ago and still very much believe that oath I took, to protect the health of the individuals that I work with. And for me, that's the kids, but it's also their families. I cannot ethically take the consideration of cost into account. I certainly work with the families to try and make sure that they have or can access the financial resources for whatever it is that I or my colleagues may be recommending, but my responsibility is to do what is in the best interest of children.
Thank you. I'm going to try to get one more quick question into you, Dr. Paulson. There was a study by Syracuse and Harvard University about the major co-pollutants that could be reduced. So can you talk about some of the health co-benefits that are likely to result from these kinds of carbon regulations?
Yes. I'm a pediatrician, but let me mention something particular to adults, and that relates to particulate pollution. We know that when particle levels go up in the air, the next day more people are going to be admitted to the hospital with heart attack and strokes and die from those heart attacks and strokes as a result of that exposure to the particulates. So that's just one example. Another example is that we know that children that grow up in areas of the country that have higher air pollution, when they are finished growing 18-20, their lungs are smaller than kids who grow up in a less polluted area. And that raises the concern of, are these kids then set up for what we think of as adult onset pulmonary disease, but actually it goes back to the pollution that they were exposed to as children.
Thank you very much. I see my time has expired. I yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Ms. Bonamici. And I'd like unanimous consent to put in the record a New York Times article just a few days ago that reveals that the EPA solicited positive comments from outside organizations, perhaps in violation of lobbying laws, without objection. And the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Babin, is recognized.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to all you witnesses for being here. The EPA Administrator, Ms. McCarthy, Gina McCarthy, wrote an op-ed recently saying that the agency's air standards attract new business, new investment, and new jobs. I don't think that Administrator McCarthy is living in the same world as the rest of us. I represent the 36th district in the state of Texas, and we have one of the largest numbers of petrochemical plants and refineries in the country. Most of my district is not in attainment with these new regulations. I will also add that neither is Yellowstone National Park in attainment with these new regulations. There is no concrete evidence to support the lower standard for ozone that the EPA is calling for, not to mention the cost that is associated with it given these strenuous economic times. I would now ask for a slide be placed on the screen to describe my district, the state of Texas, District 36. We have the largest manufacturing industry in the state of Texas in the chemical and refining industry. We directly employ or indirectly employ over 10,000 people down there in the this portion of my district, and we pay $934 million in wages in this district with an average wage of nearly $100,000. These proposed new rules promise to be the most expensive regulations in the history of the United States, likely costing us thousands of jobs and prolonging a recession. This is bureaucratic overreach in the extreme. I would ask Mr. Kovacs and Mr. Eisenberg whether this is worth putting all of this at risk with these new regulations. Mr. Kovacs.
Well, I think in terms of ozone, we've really had probably 30 years of what you're describing. I mean, look, going back to the early 1980s, many sectors of the economy, steel, foundries, carpets, furniture, foundry, what you pick it, they were, because of non-attainment areas where they could not get the credits to stay operating, were forced either, one, to other areas of the country, or, two, they were forced overseas. And so that's been going on for quite some time. Again, I come back to the fact that these are issues that really should be resolved. And let me just give you one example as to how hard it is to resolve it. We've talked about a lot about today about science and transparency, and we've challenged EPA for years. But in 1999, when the Pope and Dockery study was first issued, I wrote a FOIA to EPA and was denied everything. So all the scientific basis for a lot of what they're talking about in PM and ozone has been denied to the public. And the only people who can have access to it are EPA and their researchers. Chairman Smith issued a subpoena last year and couldn't get the information. One of the things that we need to have in this country is complete and total transparency. The agency needs to be able to put its models, its science in the record. It needs to implement the environmental or the Informational Quality Act. They need to accept information from the public, and they need to sit down and talk about it. If the data is there, then they shouldn't be afraid of it. And if it's not there, then they should be afraid of it.
Which is what the Secret Science Act is all about that we're proposing. Mr. Eisenberg.
Thank you. To your question of whether or not we believe that this is the right thing for manufacturing, no, we don't need them to change the ozone standard if you want to have a healthy manufacturing sector. I mean, that is the simple and straight answer. And this is not about health for us. We are getting the benefits of continued reductions between the existing ozone standard and the three dozen other regulations that reduce NOx emissions. We're going to be reducing ozone precursors by 36% over the next decade. So we're going to get there. We're going to actually be doing what we need to do. The only difference between that and getting and moving the chains now is that you impose a significant amount of struggle for manufacturers to try to expand or build things to get basically the same result. So we're going to get there anyway. We can just get there without all of the pain that we would have to face if you don't move the chains on ozone.
Thank you very much, and I'll yield back my time, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Beyer. Excuse me. Thank you, Mr. Babin. Mr. Beyer, the gentleman from Virginia, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Eisenberg and Mr. Kovacs both cite a study prepared on behalf of NAM in their written testimonies, and this study estimates the compliance costs associated with an ozone standard of 65 parts per billion. I have an article from Bloomberg News that discusses NAM's study, and a number of groups criticize the study and its methodology, saying that the study doesn't include an estimate of the anticipated benefits of the 65 standard. It overestimates compliant costs and that it makes, quote, unrealistic assumptions. For example, the use of the Cash for Clunkers program, with which I'm very familiar, is used as the basis for estimating the cost of unknown pollution controls. It is described, quote, as insane and unmoored from economic reality. Also, as important as it is to understand well what the new standards might cost and the savings they might generate, please allow me to point out that the 2001 Supreme Court, the same court that put George W. Bush in the White House and Bush v. Gore, ruled that the Clean Air Act prohibits the EPA from considering the cost of compliance when setting national ambient air quality standards. So, Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent to have this article entered into the record.
Without objection.
Thank you. Dr. Paulson, thank you for being here. The committee received testimony from Dr. Mary Rice on the health impacts of ozone, and she indicated that the research has only grown stronger since the last time the EPA considered revising the current standard. And one area she highlighted was the new evidence between higher ozone levels and increased mortality. I grew up here in Washington, D.C. There were a number of times this coming summer when every TV station will be telling us all to stay inside because of high ozone levels. As I understand it, the Integrated Science Assessment for Ozone states that, quote, the current body of evidence indicates there's a likely causal relationship between short-term exposures to ozone and total mortality. Can you talk about this evidence?
Yes. Ozone causes inflammation, irritation, particularly in the lungs. I think an analogy that everybody, I hope, can understand is sunburn.
Sunburn causes inflammation and irritation of the skin. And likewise, ozone does that, but it does that in the breathing tubes in the lungs. And acutely, that if it's a one-time thing, if it's a few-time thing, that heals up and goes away, just like a sunburn heals up and goes away. But on a chronic basis, that leads to permanent changes in the breathing tubes in the lung so that they no longer function the way they need to function, to remove other pollutants from the lung. They become scarred. They don't transfer oxygen and carbon dioxide the way they should. So overall, pulmonary function declines, and that impacts on a whole range of adult health issues. So I think that we need to bring the ozone level down. Levels below 60 are much safer than levels above 60, and we should have a standard of 60 in the United States.
Thank you, Dr. Paulson, very much. Mr. Kovacs, thank you for being here representing the chamber. I was president of the Falls Church Chamber on the board of the Fairfax Chamber. My wife, we used to work for you guys at the U.S. Chamber. But I'm having trouble reconciling a number of facts. On the one hand, EPA has promulgated regulations on clean air, clean water, greenhouse gases, and all allegedly are job killers and profit killers. On the other hand, corporate profits are at an all-time high. The Dow was over 18,000 last night, 62 straight months of job creation, the fastest and best recovery of any Western economy since the Great Recession. In fact, Governor McAuliffe in Virginia has now created private sector jobs, not him, but our economy in Virginia has created more private sector jobs in these first 17 months than any government in Virginia history, any new governor. In my business, when we receive a new regulation, we adapt. And we figure out the most effective way to implement and respond to the new rule, and then we figure out how to make money off of it. To Mr. Knight, who I guess is gone, my California dealer friends are the most profitable dealers in the country, despite their regulations. I would love to be a California car dealer. My question is, don't you give too little credit to the business community, to their imagination, to their operational excellence? Can't we have business and job success and better health at the same time?
Well, thank you for the question. First of all, I give tremendous credit to the business community. They are extraordinarily innovative, and I am absolutely thrilled that your wife was with the chamber and you were with Falls Church Chamber. Now, having said that, we at the chamber, we don't really, when we talk about job impact and regulatory impact, we talk about a system that the United States constantly creates jobs, and we're constantly creating more jobs and hope we will even do better in the future. But when a regulation comes out, it actually affects specific industries. When ozone comes out, for example, initially we have the history of it coming out and literally knocking out, let's just take California or any place else, the chemical manufacturing in certain areas, oil manufacturing, paint coatings. And what happens is those people truly are out of jobs. And when you look at the fact that if you're over 55 and you're out of a job, your chances are only about 25% of having a job the rest of your life. And what we're trying to impose upon them is, yes, it's easy to say, wow, we have a lot of great technology companies and they're creating a lot of jobs. What's happening is the regulations are putting people and communities out of business. And that should be just as much of a concern, because the health impacts when a community goes out of business is drug abuse, heart attack, hypertension. And all we're trying to say is, let's get the facts on the table and let's have an honest discussion. Let's put the health-related effects out. Let's put the job-related effects out. This should not be a problem. This should be a problem that Congress can solve. This shouldn't be a problem we fight over. But that's been my testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Beyer. And the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Johnson, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The discussion that we're having today about the EPA's overreach, it's a continuing dialogue, and it's disturbing. I went to Europe just a few weeks ago and talked with many of our friends and allies in Europe about energy policy, and I learned something there that I wasn't expecting to learn. Over the last 20 years, they have been advancing beyond the United States in shutting down coal-fired power and investing in renewable energies and those kinds of things, reducing the amount of coal that they had in their energy portfolio. When we talked energy policy with many of our friends there, we learned that a lot of those countries, some of those countries, are increasing their mix of coal-fired power in their energy profiles. And when we asked them why, they said, our ratepayers are simply unwilling to bear the burden of the high cost of providing energy to their homes and to their businesses. Europe has learned this lesson, that coal-fired power is still the most reliable, affordable energy on the planet. Do we need to keep our air clean? Absolutely we do. Do we need to keep our water clean? Absolutely we do. Dr. Paulson, you made an impassioned some impassioned comments about the health implications. Not everybody, though, Dr. Paulson, agrees with some of the statistics that you said. For example, today, the average life expectancy in the U.S. is 80 years, one of the highest in the world. There's a New York Times article that came out October 8, 2014, that said a child born in America today will live longer than at any other time in history. And these are scientists saying this. That report came from the Center for Disease Control. In the USA Today on April 9, 2015, it cites an EPA report that says the EPA reports that our air quality has substantially improved. Aggregate emissions of common pollutants have decreased 62% between 1980 and 2015. It is, and it goes on to say, it is unlikely that cleaner air is causing an increase in asthma. So my, you know, what I have to wrestle with, and I think what the American people are wrestling with, is when is enough enough? When does it become, when does the scale tip toward irresponsibility to continue trying to cripple the American economy and eliminate opportunities for millions of Americans just to move the CO2 emission needle a smidgen? Folks, I submit that we have reached that breaking point. We've passed that breaking point. There are serious legal questions to the EPA's jurisdiction and their legal basis for their clean power plan. And I think it's something that's got to be seriously considered by this body and by the American people. Let me get to some specific questions. Mr. Kovacs and Mr. Eisenberg, by the year 2030, the EPA believes their proposed clean power plan will allow the United States to reduce carbon emissions from the power sector by 30% or below the 2005 levels, a roughly 17% cut from 2013 levels. To achieve these reductions, EPA calculated a specific emissions rate for each state by totaling the CO2 emissions produced by each state's electricity generating units and dividing it from the total amount of electricity generated by the EGUs. Then, the EPA proposed emissions reduction targets based on the carbon intensity of each state's electricity sector. My question to you, gentlemen, do you believe the proposed performance standards are achievable, Mr. Kovacs?
I think the easiest way to address your question is to start off with one of your conclusions, where enough is enough. And I think at that point in time, I don't think you can get to dealing with the present regulatory system without a change in the Administrative Procedure Act. And Chairman Smith is very familiar with this. But right now, you can't get the kind of data into the system that you need. You can't get the agency to participate, and you can't get the agency to look and talk to the public the way it needs to. And until you can get the kind of early on input where people say, here's what we think, and the agency says, here's what we have, and you begin the discussion 90 days before a rule, and then you begin to have the Information Quality Act put into the system where people can actually say, oh, this is the data. Congress has to find some way to get the process to work. There is nothing with the way the court decisions have come down on deference and with the way the agencies ignore Congress. Congress has to make a fundamental change in how rules are made. And the last point, because I don't want to just filibuster, but the last point is there are 4,000 rules coming out every year. 3,700 really
work. 95% of the system works. We're talking two or three or four major rules a year, and most of those rules come out of the EPA. So when you look at the whole regulatory system, you don't need to throw it all away. But for those major rules that are over $1 billion that fundamentally change society, you have to have a new way of approaching it.
My time's expired, but Mr. Eisenberg, would you want to respond to that?
Sure. I mean, certainly in the case of ozone, these rules are not achievable. And it's actually a good opportunity to explain what our study said. Our study actually had the same methodology as EPA's study. I mean, it was exactly the same. As far as known controls, we used the same stuff, same numbers, because we believed them. Where we differ with EPA is on the 65% of controls that you need to comply that are unknown controls. You don't have to, it's not the, you still have to do it. We just have to figure out how to do it at that point. I would love to be able to say that we can innovate, and maybe we will.
Thank you, Mr. Eisenberg. Thank you, Mr. Johnson, as well. The gentleman from New York, Mr. Tonko, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to our witnesses. Mr. Chair, in his testimony, Mr. Eisenberg cites a study released by the National Association of Manufacturers last September, I believe. It's entitled The Cost of Federal Regulation to the United States Economy, Manufacturing, and Small Business. According to the study, regulations cost the economy $2 trillion in 2012. Now, fortunately, a review of that study was done. The results of that study indicate clearly that that number is not accurate and that number is based on a flawed analysis. I have here in front of me a review of the National Association of Manufacturers study by Professor Kolstad from Stanford University. Professor Kolstad, in this study, was asked to grade it and gave it a C-. In his review of the study, he states that the, and I quote, study reads as an advocacy document. The authors focus only on the costs of regulation, ignoring the benefits. The authors also don't follow the standard in academic practice of discussing uncertainties in their analyses, and their results are highly uncertain. All of these factors make it difficult to determine the quality of the responses and lead to the conclusions that the results are unreliable, close quote. Mr. Chair, I ask that, by unanimous consent, that the review of the National Association of Manufacturers study be entered into the record.
Okay, without objection.
Dr. Paulson, as you are well aware, beyond the economic costs associated with climate change, there are very serious public health risks related to increases in the global temperature. For example, longer heat waves, changes in water and air quality, and foodborne and insect-borne disease. Climate change also has the potential to exacerbate existing health conditions such as asthma and adversely impact vulnerable populations like children that you serve and the elderly. What kinds of ongoing health risks are expected if the current climate trends continue? And do these risks, in your opinion, vary by region of our country?
Mr. Tonko, yes, they do vary by region. We are already seeing significant impacts in terms of injuries and deaths among native populations in Alaska because of changes in the ice and other factors there. We will and are seeing in the rest of the country we will see more problems with asthma, as you have mentioned. We have seen over the last 5 to 10 years a change in the range, the number of counties and states that where Lyme disease is a problem, and as the climate continues to change, we will see continued changes in that disease and other diseases, such as we may begin to see indigenous malaria here in the United States. We will start to have problems from sea level rise. I'm a resident of Virginia. I live in Mr. Byers' district. So we don't quite see that so much in Alexandria, but certainly in the Norfolk region, the Hampton Roads region. We are seeing that, and that will continue and impact on other parts of the country. With sea level rise, we lose quality of water for agriculture and for drinking. So there's going to be a vast array of impacts. It will vary by part of the country, and it will disproportionately, and these impacts will disproportionately fall on children and other vulnerable populations.
Right. And we've also seen some of the proposals, the expected impacts on coastal areas of New York State. How can implementing the Clean Power Plan help states address these public health impacts of climate change?
First and foremost, all reductions in CO2 production will slow the rate of temperature change associated with excess CO2. And if we can get CO2 levels down in the long run, while some of these issues will continue to occur for a while, we can stop the progress of climate change in the long run. I think that, again, in the long run, we need to be very concerned about food availability and quality of food that's going to be impacted from higher temperatures. People are literally, and we're seeing this unfortunately now in India, people are literally not going to be able to go out and plant and harvest when the temperatures are extremely high. The plants will not grow and produce the bountiful resources that we require and derive from them. The quality of the food may be decreased. So there are a lot of impacts that we're going to have to deal with.
Thank you. And with that, Mr. Chair, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Tonko. And the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Nagelbauer, is recognized. Oh, I'm sorry. I skipped over Mr. Loudermilk from Georgia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One of the issues that we run into, I've found out my brief time here in Congress, is getting down to the true facts. And part of getting to true facts in science is that getting away from presenting facts that justify an end, but making your end justified off the facts that are before you. I live 10 miles from one of the largest coal-fired plants in the nation. And, Mr. Chairman, to your point earlier, this plant, you really can't see the smoke when it comes out. But what comes out is white, but it's steam that's used to cool that. But, Dr. Paulson, you brought up something that was concerning to me, because I live 10 miles from one of the largest coal-fired plants in the nation. My one-year-old granddaughter lives about 11 miles from it. And you brought up in your statement, you said that outdoor air pollution is linked to respiratory problems in children, including decreased lung function, coughing, wheezing, more frequent respiratory illnesses, and so on. And that is true. A quick check, you're absolutely right. It is linked to air pollution. But Dr. Paulson, can you tell me what is the greatest contributing factor to asthma worldwide, according to the World Health Organization?
I don't know exactly what the World Health Organization has said is the greatest contributing factor. Genetics is certainly an issue. Smoking is clearly an issue. That's another form.
Do you know where air pollution ranks?
No, sir, I don't.
Last. Okay. The greatest contributor to asthma, and I was surprised to find out that asthma is one of the top causes of deaths in children worldwide. I was very shocked. The top seven contributors are all related to poor sanitary conditions in the home, which are linked to poverty. It is greatest in the most impoverished nations in the world. Number seven is outdoor allergens, which if somebody could do something about pollen in Georgia, I'd really appreciate it. But the only thing you can do is cut down trees, and we've been stopped from doing that as well. Tobacco smoke is number eight. Number nine is chemical irritants in the workplace, which again goes back to industrialized nations that don't have the regulations that we have in place. Number 10 and last is air pollution. I live, as I said, 10 miles from the largest coal-fired plant in the nation, but it happens to be the cleanest, one of the cleanest coal-fired plants in the nation. Georgia Power, who runs that plant, has spent twice as much money in cleaning up the emissions from that plant as it costs to build the plant when it was first constructed. But a few years ago, because of this administration's regulations, Georgia Power had to shut down three coal-fired plants, which cost 700 jobs. Now, I don't have anything to enter into the record, Mr. Chairman, other than what I've seen with my own eyes. If you've ever gone into an area, especially in our part of Georgia, where a plant has shut down, in a lot of cases it's because they couldn't afford to operate because of the regulatory environment in this nation, you go into those areas where those workers, which are usually factory workers who are skilled in that particular job, have no other job to go to. When you go in those towns, you start seeing these type of issues. You see poor sanitary conditions because they're unemployed or they're underemployed, they have no job at all. They're doing what they can to scrape by, and we start seeing an increase in poverty. So my question is, are we throwing out the baby with the bathwater because we're focusing on what is the least contributing factor toward a disease which would result in a greater contributing factor as more Americans lose their jobs, as more jobs go overseas? In fact, the president signed an agreement with China that they would promise to start limiting their emissions by 2030 while we're lowering our emissions, pushing more jobs overseas. So my question to the panel is, am I off base? Are we going to lose more jobs in this nation because of the direction we're going, which will result in a problem greater than what we have right now? Mr. Eisenberg, you're in the manufacturing arena, and that's where we've seen the greatest impact.
I mean, look, understand what I'm saying today. We, in almost every case, we're comfortable with regulation, but we have regulation, and those regulations are working. And it's really about figuring out where that sweet spot is between having a regulation that protects the environment and health and making sure that we can actually do our jobs. In the cases that we've cited today, they've gone a step too far. We're asking them to take a step back towards normalcy.
With that, Mr. Chairman, I see I'm out of time. I would love to continue this on, but I'll yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Lauderbilt. Appreciate that. The gentleman from Texas, Mr. Nagelbauer, is recognized for questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Carr, you know, since 1986, EPA and the Corps has only had jurisdictions over the wetlands adjacent to other jurisdictional waters. Can you explain in detail the rule's new concept of adjacent waters?
Yes.
I'm over here in the cheap seats. So,
yeah. Thank you, Congressman. Prior to the new rule, through court precedent, the Corps regulated wetlands that were adjacent to waters that themselves were not wetlands. What does that mean? If you go to a major river and there's a large wetland next to the river, there's a dike built through that wetland, the wetland on the other side of the dike, the landward side, was regulated. But if there was a small pond that had been abandoned because the farmer stopped working a certain area or he moved hogs off of that area and that pond was in a field that became wooded and he didn't use it for more than 5 years, the Corps would typically consider that an isolated water. And that's the way it's been working up till May 27th with the new rule. Under the new rule, that pond can now be regulated as an adjacent water. So it's a change in how they approach it. The other thing is that there's a site that I worked on with a development client where there were several small isolated wetlands. The Corps of Engineers back in the late 90s confirmed them to be isolated wetlands, and the Commonwealth of Virginia regulated those wetlands. Under today's rule, those wetlands would also be considered adjacent under the jurisdiction of the federal government. So those are two ways that it's changed.
So to your knowledge, is there legal precedent for the agencies to establish jurisdiction over these waters?
The short answer is no. There is no court decision that required the Corps of Engineers to change how adjacency was determined, to my knowledge. And I've been doing it for 26 years.
So as a wetlands delineator, can you describe how the new adjacent waters definitions, including the neighboring definition, will change the way you make your jurisdictional determinations?
Yeah, those two examples are two clear examples. The third is the portion, much like manufacturers. I mean, there are certain parts of this rule that are understandable. They're relatively reasonable. The one issue with adjacency that gives me greatest concern is the criteria that says any water within 1,500 feet of a traditionally navigable water is by definition, by rule, adjacent and therefore jurisdictional under the Clean Water Act. In the coastal areas, and I come from the coastal plain of Virginia, but this goes from Texas to to the coast of New York, you are now extending this measuring stick out 1,500 feet, and anything that falls within that, and you measure it 1,500 feet from the innermost limits of tidal waters, tidal creeks, tidal bays, miles inland from the ocean, you extend this measuring stick 1,500 feet, and anything within that zone is jurisdictional as an adjacent water by rule. That's a dramatic change.
I want to get to something about talking about ditches, and I think one of the things that my agriculture community thinks has concerns that by those people that believe that EPA has exempted some of the ditches from their jurisdiction. So there are EPAs telling, I guess, the agricultural community that. Do you believe that's, in fact, true?
If I could give you just a little context for my opinion on that. Our firm just recently completed a delineation that involved over 56,000 linear feet of ditches. So just around 10 miles of ditches. We had to walk them all, and we asserted they were non-jurisdictional. It took over about a year, I think, to get the confirmation that, in fact, they were non-jurisdictional. Under today's rule, I can tell you, I can walk you to these ditches that are now jurisdictional. As has been said, there are two criteria about ditches that I think are fine, and they're the first two. The last one, to me, is a recapture provision. And in fact, I went through the entire preamble, 200 pages. I've read what I can find on it, and there's not a specific mention of how they arrived at the third criteria. And the issue with it is that it says ditches that don't flow through another water are exempt. Ditches virtually by definition flow into a water of the United States. And we have an example where the water of the United States was a channelized stream, was 8 feet below grade. There are some ditches 3 feet below grade that, kind of like a waterfall, discharge into this creek. The water never, this ditch does not touch the bottom of that ditch. The water falls through the air about 5 feet, runs down the edge of the embankment when there's water. These are intermittent streams. Those ditches would be regulated as a tributary of the United States under this rule. I'm sure of it.
So there is still confusion out there and uncertainty when it comes to the ditches issue?
Yes, sir. If I could, one suggestion I would have, and it seems to work in Virginia. I don't want to claim that it would work nationally. But I would like to see, as someone else here mentioned, an opportunity where the EPA gets a roundtable together, a technical advisory committee, and allows that technical advisory committee to provide direct input, and it would have conservation groups, industry, consultants, the entire gamut, work on an issue for, in Virginia it's up to 180 days before a rule goes out for public comment. So you'd still have public comment. I think 180 days is better than 90. I think with these large regulatory issues, they're too complicated to do too quickly.
Okay, Mr. Kerr, I think that's a good idea. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Nagelbauer. The gentleman from Texas, Mr. Weber, is recognized.
Thank you. Mr. Kerr, you said earlier isolated wetlands were not regulated by the EPA according to a Supreme Court case. Can you give me the name of that case?
Yes, Swank.
S-W-A-N-K?
S-W-A-N-C-C, I think, Southern Waste Management Authority.
Okay.
It was a county in Chicago.
Perfect. Thank you. Mr. Eisenberg, you said manufacturers use one-third of the energy in the United States. I often, you know, I have five ports in Texas. We export a whole lot of things, and we have a whole lot of petrotechs, chemical industry, and oil and natural gas, and on and on and on. When I speak to groups, I often say that the things that make America great are the things that America makes. How do we do that? With a stable, reliable, affordable, dependable energy supply. Mr. Kerr, would you agree with that? That America is great because of the things we make, and we have a good energy supply to fuel, for lack of a better word, our industry?
Yes.
Mr. Kovacs, would you agree with that? Dr. Paulson, would you agree with that?
I don't know enough to comment. I think you're right, but I don't know.
Mr. Eisenberg, would you agree with that?
I do.
Good. Mr. Eisenberg, you also said that 65% of the controls the EPA was mandating were not identifiable. Is that true?
Yes, it's EPA's term of art. They call them unknown controls. They just can't tell us what they are.
And Mr. Kovacs, if I remember your testimony, you said that the EPA itself said this was going to be the most expensive regulation in history, but that it wouldn't impact states.
Yes, they have this technical where if it's a mandate, the state has to do it. They don't count it as.
So that was your comment, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. So let me come back to you, Mr. Kovacs. It's the most expensive regulatory rule in history, but it's not going to impact states. Does that sound commonsensical to you, Mr. Kovacs?
Well, that's been the point of my testimony. The Congress has legislated for years common sense, and you haven't gotten it.
So is your answer no? It's not commonsensical. Mr. Kerr, would you agree that that statement doesn't sound commonsensical? It's the most expensive regulation in history, but it won't impact states.
I think that's nonsensical.
Dr. Paulson, would you agree with that?
Sir, I have no idea what the context is, so I can't comment.
Mr. Eisenberg, would you agree with that?
I would agree with that.
Okay. Mr. Eisenberg, when an energy plant builds a plant, and I had a nuclear plant in my district when I was state rep, someone comes in to build an energy plant, permitting and all, the process takes 3 to 5 years?
If you're lucky.
If we're lucky. Okay. So if it's that hard on us, and the EPA is making it harder and harder and harder, and it's billions of dollars, is it any wonder, does it surprise you that some of those investors that have that kind of money to invest actually send that money overseas? Does that surprise you?
It doesn't at all. Streamlining that process is a priority.
Just yes or no. Dr. Paulson, does that surprise you?
Again, it's beyond my expertise, sir.
It's above your level of pay grade?
I don't use that terminology, but it's beyond my expertise.
Mr. Kovacs, does that surprise you? Mr. Kerr?
The energy policy is outside my purview.
Okay. When I was a state rep, I came up here to D.C. in March of 2010. I was on the Environmental Reg Committee in Texas to Energy and the Environment Committee meeting, National Conference of State Legislators, NTSL. Heard with my own ears an undersecretary for the EPA back then say that they wanted to permit farms because of global warming, greenhouse gases, average farm permit, $26,500 per farm. Now, they had done the math. And, doctor, I trust you can do math. Okay, good, because you didn't seem to want to weigh in on most of those other questions. They had calculated the income stream. Now, this is their words, not mine, a revenue stream of $600 million. Turns out, you know, that the streams on farms and ranches aren't the only streams the EPA is interested in, okay? $600 million. Now, is the EPA really only interested in science? When they say they want to permit farms and it produces a revenue stream of $600 million, does that sound like they're interested in more than science, Mr. Eisenberg?
So I don't know that I can effectively answer that one, but, they need to find a balance.
They do. They're going to kill our energy supply if we're not careful. And, Dr. Paulson, we're going to wind up, the poor kids are going to all be broke. They're going to be healthy, but we're all going to be broke. That's the danger of losing jobs and sending our energy overseas, because China and Mexico and India are not going to follow suit. So I'm going to stop there. That's my editorial Mr. Chairman, I appreciate you. When you go over, I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Weber. And the gentleman from Alabama, Mr. Palmer, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to start out by addressing air quality. And I have here the air quality section from a report done by the Alabama Policy Institute that shows that since 1980, our GDP has increased by 467%. Vehicle miles traveled up 94%. Population's grown by 38%. Energy consumption's up 22%. But emissions are down 50%. When you look at the air quality index and the percentage of days per year that the air quality index exceeded the standards, we went from about 24% in 1980 to about 2%. So there's no question that we have done an excellent job of improving air quality, yet the asthma rate has gone up. I think that's been mentioned several times. I'd also like to point out that there might be other factors that cause asthma rates to have gone up. And, for instance, here's a report from UCLA, University of California, Los Angeles, in case someone wonders what the acronym is. It says asthma disproportionately affects low-income populations. And the percentages are astonishing, frankly. That it would have such a higher prevalence among low-income families when I think, and I'll ask my colleague from California, Mr. Knight, I believe that higher-income families breathe the same air as the low-income families. So just, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to enter into the record the article and the section from the report on air quality. And also point
out... Without objection.
Thank you. As well that... there is an estimate on what the new ozone regulations will cost. I find it interesting, Mr. Kerr, that the EPA seems to think that there's not going to be an impact. Is it possible, in your mind, just rationally thinking this through, that the additional regulations that are being imposed on businesses that are going to result in substantial job losses, that's going to result in less disposable household income, that will result in lower incomes, could have a more negative effect on health and well-being of people than any positive effect that additional regulations would impose, considering the improvements that we've made already?
I'll have to concede to the others because I don't do air quality consulting at all. I'm not involved.
My question is, do the people who work for the businesses of the United States and earn income do better in terms of health and well-being than people who have no income and no job?
Yes, sir, they do.
That's part of what I would consider common sense policy. In May of... In a May 29, 2015 interview with PBS NewsHour, EPA Administrator Gina McCarthy stated the following: "The farmers will know very clearly here we are clearly explaining that irrigation ditches are not included. We have clearly said in the rule beyond this rule adds absolutely no regulatory or permitting issue to agriculture whatsoever." Do you agree with that statement?
No, I don't. If I could get a chance to elaborate at some point, I'd like to give you time. Ask your questions.
Okay. Well, we'll come back to that as the last opportunity for you to speak. Mr. Kerr, former EPA Office of Water Deputy Administrator Nancy Stoner previously stated that the rule will not have a negative effect on small businesses. She said the agency sought early and wide input from small businesses while developing the proposed rule, including meetings as far back as 2011. Do you agree with this statement that the rule will not have a negative impact on small businesses?
I disagree with the statement. I've talked to small home builders. It's already have, you know, regulatory creep is already having an effect.
Well, that conclusion is consistent with what the National Federation of Independent Business concluded. They had a small business optimism index and found that small business owners attributed regulations as the single most important problem facing businesses today. So you said that you'd like to elaborate on something. You may do so.
Thank you. Two parts. When a farmer in Chesapeake is looking to sell his land and needs a wetland delineation done so that the prospective purchaser can determine where they can build, we are walking out into soybean fields and looking at areas that show up as moist signatures on aerial photographs and looking to see if there might be some wetland plants or stunted vegetation in a crop field. And the Corps of Engineers, before this rule, are regulating those areas as wetlands. Now, if they're isolated, then the federal government does not take jurisdiction, the Commonwealth of Virginia would. If they're adjacent to a ditch that's adjacent to a wetland, all of a sudden they are regulating them. Now, that has already crept into the procedure, and I've argued consistently that it shouldn't, because Congress went to the Corps back in 1990 and said, create what's called a PC cropland, a prior converted cropland. There was a regulatory guidance letter the Corps put out, 90-7, that spelled out the procedures for that, that exempted agricultural fields as long as they didn't pond or flood for 7 to 14 days. Any portions that did would be considered a farmed wetland and be regulated. In 93, the EPA and the Corps put out a rule that said we're codifying Regulatory Guidance Letter 90-7. And you would think, I'm a consultant, I know 90-7. They said they codified it, which would have perpetuated this exemption for most farm fields that were farmed prior to 85, don't pond or flood for very long duration, and have never been abandoned for more than 5 years. With that rule in place, they're now telling me that what that actually means is that they don't recognize the prior converted cropland rule created by the NRCS under the Food Subsidy Act, and that the Corps doesn't recognize 90-7 anymore at all, anywhere, at any time. And I've repeatedly asked the question. Now, in the rule that's just been passed, they simply said, we're not changing that, because that's not part of our charge. They changed adjacency definition. That wasn't part of their charge. I would love to see Congress, to me there's no confusion. In fact, there's a court in Florida that's already decided this case, which I brought to the Corps' attention, which didn't get any traction. And that judge said, you can have two different rules that use the same phrase, and they mean two different things because they fall under two federal laws. That's not occurring. And we have farm ditches and farmland being regulated today, and it'll continue.
Mr. Chairman, just one last point. I want to point out that Dr. Philip Lloyd, former UN International Panel on Climate Change lead author, found that global temperature change over the last 100 years is well within the natural variability of the last 8,000 years. Standard deviation over the last 8,000 years is 0.98 degrees Celsius. I want to emphasize 0.98.
Thank
over
you,
the last 100 years, it's been 0.85 degrees Celsius.
Thank you, Mr. Palmer. And if you would, give us a document to put in the record as well.
Thank you.
Mr. Molinar, the gentleman from Michigan, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Kerr, I'd just like to continue following up with you and then also talk to Mr. Kovacs and Mr. Eisenberg on some of the waters of the U.S. Issues. What, in your judgment, there were some court cases, there's the Clean Air Act, and there was an effort by the EPA to clarify its jurisdiction. Is that really how we've gotten to this point?
Yes, there were a few Supreme Court decisions, Swank being one, Rapanos being one of the other two or three major ones. That's correct.
Okay. And so, is it, in your judgment, were they trying to solve a policy problem that existed out there where people throughout the country were saying, there's not enough water, or what problem, other than the legal issues, were they trying to solve?
They had two real problems. One is the legal question, and there was some ambiguity because of multiple Supreme Court decisions that had to be looked at in the field, and then became the practical problem of how do you provide guidance to regulatory staff and consultants that's clear, easily understandable, and could be consistently applied not only in an area, but across the entire country. So that was the challenge. And they tried to take in science. And in the preamble of the rule, they said those are the three compelling issues they have to deal with, science, policy, and law. And they said that science, in fact, falls short in certain areas, and they've got to reach a policy decision that's consistent with law.
And in your judgment, it's gotten actually more complicated. Some of these new definitions have, rather than giving clarity, have really expanded their jurisdiction and raised a number of new questions.
Yeah, they've kind of moved items around, and so things that were previously one thing, like possibly an isolated water that wasn't regulated, can become an adjacent water. The other thing is they did create a bright line, but the bright line, and I'm speaking specifically to Rule A8, wetlands that show a significant nexus to traditionally navigable waters, allows that to be applied to any feature within 4,000 feet of an ordinary high watermark or a tributary. Now, we're not talking about rivers, we're not talking about streams, we're not talking about creeks. Where I come from, there were creeks, then there were smaller ones that were cricks. We're not talking about those. We're way up into the headwaters of ephemeral and intermittent streams, and then going 4,000 feet out to determine a significant nexus. My point is that that includes virtually the entire watershed of virtually every place that I've looked. So they created a bright line, but it includes everything.
So in your judgment, and I wanted to hear from Mr. Kovacs and Mr. Eisenberg, do you view this as a significant expansion of their jurisdiction, of their authority? I mean, is that your conclusion?
Well, it's not any clearer. They've expanded jurisdiction into areas that heretofore may not have been regulated or weren't regulated, and the procedures aren't any clearer. They've provided some bright lines, and some of those are commendable, but others are just they kind of grab all kinds of things and don't create the simplicity that anyone was looking for.
Okay. Mr. Kovacs, do you view this as a significant expansion of their jurisdiction or authority?
It's certainly a significant expansion of their authority. I think what troubles me the most in this whole argument is not once in all the hundreds of pages that they have did they ever say that the states weren't doing a good job on state waters, which is really remarkable. Second, they've never said that the water quality that was administered by the states was in any way impaired. That's quite remarkable. Under unfunded mandates, they make it very clear that they are imposing no mandates on state and local governments. And in terms of small business, they say there's absolutely no impact, even though they're greatly enhancing jurisdiction. This is a shell game, and this is what the whole regulatory process has become, and that's why I keep on pleading Congress really needs to take more of an action to get back in the game.
Let me go to Mr. Eisenberg.
So we just finished our annual fly-in. We have about 500 manufacturers coming to town. I had dinner two nights ago with about 25 of them to talk specifically about water issues, water scarcity, waters of the U.S., things like this. And at the end of the meal, I said, look, are you guys in a better place because of this regulation? And every single one of them said no. It is still causing them headaches. All we wanted was clarity. Had we gotten clarity, my testimony would have been a lot different today. We didn't get it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Molinar. Before we conclude, Dr. Paulson, I was going to mention to you that we contacted the assistant director of the Capital Power Plant, and he confirmed that whether it burns natural gas or coal, the smoke is still white. And while I certainly have sympathy for any child who's gotten asthma, you might want to check with the doctor about his statement that whenever the smoke turned black, the asthma became worse. I'm not sure that there's a basis for that, but look forward to hearing more information about it as well. Thank you, the gentlewoman from Texas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me thank all the witnesses, but I want to ask unanimous consent to put an article from a scientific magazine in the record that speaks to the role of science and rulemaking process.
Okay, without objection. We thank you all for your testimony today. Very helpful, very informative, and we stand adjourned.